This program is brought to you by Link TV for educational and non-commercial use only. Mosaic, a daily news program from Link TV, presents a selection of news reports from independent and state-controlled broadcasters from throughout the Middle East.
Once again, the legitimacy of trying prominent members of the previous Iraqi regime is being raised. Today, the first hearing will begin for the trial of Tariq Aziz, the most prominent figure of the late Iraqi President Saddam Hussein. The point of difference in this trial is that Aziz will be tried as a defendant in a criminal case for ordering the execution of Iraqi merchants at a time when he was in a diplomatic position as the Iraqi foreign minister.
He lost the hope which he had 5 years ago when he voluntarily surrendered himself to the U.S. forces in order to avoid standing trial. The name Tariq Aziz appeared in the case of the execution of 42 Iraqi merchants in 1992, during the siege that was imposed on the country after the Iraqi invasion of Kuwait. Also being charged in the case are seven senior officials of the Saddam era, including Ali Hassan al-Majid, known as Chemical Ali. Many observers took note when they learned about accusations against Tariq Aziz, given that he played a diplomatic role for the country.
His duties were related to political and foreign issues. I'm surprised by the presence of his name in this case.
The most distinguished aspect of this trial is that the judge is Raouf Rashid Abdul Rahman, who sentenced to death the late President Saddam Hussein in 2006. The accusation of executing Iraqi merchants appears different from previous trials because it does not have political or sectarian overtones. In this case, the court charged all the members of the Revolutionary Leadership Council, including Tariq Aziz. Away from the political and legal debates, only the families of the victims view this trial as an answer to questions which had remained unanswered for 16 years.
At the time, I asked them, "Where are you taking my father?" They said, "We want to ask him questions and then we will bring him back." They never brought him back since that day.
Another wound is being reopened in a country that appears to be in constant state of suffering, this time between the victims and the victimizers.
In another development, the Israeli Prime Minister Ehud Olmert vowed to continue the military operations in the Gaza Strip. During a meeting for his government, Olmert said that as long as the launching of rockets at the Israelis continues, the Israeli army will continue its military action. In addition, Olmert expressed regret over what he referred to as a tragic incident that resulted in the death of a mother and her four children in Beit Hanun yesterday.
The situation in the Gaza Strip returned to dominate the agenda of the Israeli government. While the Israeli cabinet failed to adopt a clear position regarding whether it accepts or rejects the cooling-off period proposed by the Palestinian resistance factions, the Israeli Prime Minister briefly hinted around it, hoping that the Palestinian factions will stop rocket attacks on Israel. Olmert started the meeting by offering his deep regrets over the killing of a Palestinian mother and her four children in Beit Hanun and held Hamas responsible for the death of Palestinian civilians.
I hope that the terrorist organizations in the Gaza Strip will stop their attacks on Israeli civilians. As long as they continue their attacks, we have no choice but to fight them. We deeply regret the fall of Palestinian civilians, who have no relations with the terrorists.
However, some Israeli ministers were clearer than Olmert and completely rejected the cooling off period.
The IDF have to continue its own operation.
The Israeli Defense Army must continue its military operations in Gaza day and night and must do so until the terrorists surrender.
A firmer position than that of Olmert was adopted by the Israeli Defense Minister Ehud Barak during a tour near the apartheid wall in the West Bank. Barak summed up his position in two words.
I believe that we are engaged in a confrontation with Hamas and not in a cooling off period. This is the right description of the situation.
Meanwhile, the Palestinian side, which discussed with the quartet's envoy Tony Blair the situation in the West Bank and accused Israel of failing to meet its obligations regarding the military checkpoints, expressed hope for the success of truce efforts in the Gaza Strip.
The cooling off period is a very important process. If it is implemented, it will help ease the suffering of our people in the Gaza Strip. Egypt is exerting serious efforts in this direction. These efforts come in the context of ongoing consultation with our Egyptian brothers.
Amidst this, the Palestinian resistance factions continue launching cross-border rocket attacks on Israeli towns, inflicting casualty among the Israelis and causing property damage. It seems that the Israeli position regarding the cooling off period is still ambiguous, as Israel keeps one door open for a truce while keeping another for an escalation. By adopting this dual position, Israel wants to show that it's not negotiating with an organization such as Hamas, which has labeled as a terrorist entity. With this, Israel wants to mandate its conditions for any truce.
Israel's Deputy Prime Minister Shaul Mofaz said that returning the Golan Heights to Syria will give Iran a foothold on a strategic area overlooking Israel. With this, Mofaz rejected the offer that was made by the Israeli Prime Minister Ehud Olmert through the Turkish Prime Minister that Israel is willing to withdraw from the Golan Heights in exchange for peace with Syria.
In a speech to the Israeli Army broadcasting station, Mofaz said Syria is part of a radical alliance, and the Israeli withdrawal from the Golan Heights means that Iran will be there.
As soon as the shadow of Erdogan left from Damascus, and after saying that Olmert was willing to withdraw from the Golan in exchange for peace, an Israeli voice came out from Washington warning against even the thought of leaving the Golan. Shaul Mofaz lashed out at the messages exchanged between his prime minister and his party with Syria. From a standpoint of the former chief of staff for the Israeli army, Mofaz didn't see in the Golan Heights more than a strategic hill overlooking northern Israel. According to Mofaz, if the Golan Heights is returned to Syria, which is a close ally of nuclear Iran, the Iranians will set a strategic foot there, overlooking an entity that their president wants to wipe off the map. Regardless whether Mofaz's comments show a fluctuation in the internal Israeli position over the major issues, or whether his comments undermine Olmert's political credibility, this disparity raises questions regarding the seriousness of Olmert's proposal from the start, which some believe was politically motivated and aims at dismantling Syria's alliance with Israel. It seems that Olmert wants to drag Syria into endless negotiations similar to those previous talks, which have lasted more than 10 years without any fruitful results regarding the Golan Heights that has been occupied since 1967. Away from the objective and timing of Mofaz's comments, the place where they were made is also questionable. Mofaz issued his remarks after talking with U.S. Secretary of State, following a strategic security meeting that is held periodically between the two allies. While Rice didn't comment on the statement issued by Mofaz, many believe that the U.S. message to Syria arrived several days ago, when Washington showed pictures of what it described as Syrian nuclear reactor shelled last year by Israel. Washington further claimed that Syria wants to possess a nuclear military program. Mofaz said that Hezbollah is in control of southern Lebanon and the U.N. Security Council Resolution 1701 2001, which was issued after the Israeli war on Lebanon nearly 2 years ago, has been taken out of context. In brief, Mufaz said that the radical alliance led by Iran is gaining momentum, and this situation must be changed. What's more important is that Mufaz discussed with Rice ways to accomplish just that.
This afternoon, the head of Army Intelligence, Major General Amos Yedlin, briefed the ministers, and he said that terrorists in Gaza are planning a major terror attack for Independence Day. He said that it could include the kidnapping of soldiers and might be similar to the attack at Kerem Shalom on the eve of Passover. Yedlin said peace isn't even on the menu of Hamas. Security forces will, of course, be on top alert. And now to return to yesterday's tragedy in Beit Hanun. As you say, Prime Minister Olmert opened the cabinet meeting by voicing his own sorrow and that of the government of Israel for the tragic incident. But he stressed, we feel sorrow also for our own children who have been victimized for so many years by Palestinians. In terror. Olmert said, we feel sorrow for the boy from Sderot whose leg was amputated a few weeks ago. We feel sorry that Israeli citizens have had to live under constant terrorist threat for so many years. The Prime Minister also stressed, our regrets are true and more genuine than the fake remorse of the terror organizations that expose their own citizens to such injuries. As for the ongoing efforts by Hamas to reach a ceasefire with Israel, Olmert appeared to be signaling tacit acceptance of the move when he told his ministers, I hope that the brutal fight of the terror groups against Israel will end, but he added, as long as their fight continues, we will be forced to fight them. Deputy Prime Minister Eli Ishai of Shas bemoaned the fact that the world protests only when Palestinians are hurt and is indifferent to Israeli casualties. Ishai, like so many before him, called for an improvement in Israel's hasbara, or public relations effort. And Interior Minister Meir Shitrit came out against a truce with Hamas, saying it would allow the terrorists to regroup and rearm. Let's hear what Shitrit had to say about yesterday's incident in Beit Hanun.
We have to break them down. There is no other way to solve this problem. I'm against any ceasefire with the Hamas, because every ceasefire has been used by them just to buy and smuggle inside Gaza more sophisticated arms, weapon, which can use them on the next turn. Therefore, we don't have to give them such an advantage. We have to continue this operation and this campaign until we will arrive to a full stop of terror, of possibilities of terror against Israel.
Well, it's a scene that no father could possibly imagine. The sight of his four young children and his wife being, in his words, blown away by an Israeli missile. Ahmed Abu Mattag is still coming to terms with his loss. A loss, he tells Al Jazeera, he witnessed from just 10 meters away. He says he saw the explosion and that his wife was killed as she fed their 10-month-old baby. Well, Israel's prime minister is expressing his deep regret. But Israel's military is still refusing to take responsibility. Later, we'll be hearing from a spokesperson for the Israeli prime minister. But first, David Chaytor returned to the scene to launch his own investigation.
No words can describe what the father of the family must be feeling in his heart today. The horror of what he witnessed was still haunting him.
I was out in the street 10 meters far from my house. Suddenly, I saw an explosion in the front of my house into the door. I was surprised that it smashed the door and the kids while they were having their breakfast. We couldn't separate their bodies from each other. My wife was feeding the 10-month baby in her arms. I was surprised to find them in pieces. We couldn't distinguish the body of my wife from the baby. I fainted and I fell down from what I saw.
Researchers from the human rights group B'Tselem say the missile was fired from an Israeli drone aimed at an unarmed resistance fighter who was walking past the gate. Seconds before, it had fired a missile at this spot where three other fighters were standing 50 meters from the house. These are photographs of the rocket-propelled grenades and the launcher they were carrying along with a Kalashnikov in a bag they had already placed on the ground. It did not explode and was recovered from the scene. The Israeli army are now conducting an inquiry into how the family were killed. But there is no initial evidence to back up their claim of a secondary explosion, which they say put these children into the morgue. One of the family, 10-year-old Asma, survived the strike. She is still fighting for her life in hospital. A writer in one of Israel's main newspapers today said words like uninvolved civilians, armed men, or a necessary operation caused the ears to be sealed, the heart to be fossilized, and any sympathy for human life to vanish. Five more unquiet graves have been dug in the sands of Gaza's cemeteries. A family together in death as they were in life.
جدد النائب سعد الحريري احد اقطاب الاكثريه النيابيه في لبنان تاييده
Parliament member and the head of the Lebanese majority Saad al-Hariri expressed his support for a dialogue with the opposition provided that it will lead to the election of a president during the upcoming parliamentary session set for May 13, 2008. In an earlier announcement the head of the Lebanese parliament and a top opposition leader Nabih Berri called for a dialogue between the opposition and the majority to help resolve the political crisis that has rocked the country for more than a year and a half. Meanwhile, the former Lebanese Prime Minister Salim Al-Hosn said that his country was looking forward to a Saudi-sponsored initiative aimed at resolving the suffocating political crisis in Lebanon.
Every time the sun shines in Lebanon and Shahrazad stops telling her stories, the Lebanese postpone another parliamentary session to elect their president, thus taking their country back to point zero. Having said that, the next parliamentary session scheduled for May 13 may get postponed as well, especially if the political situation continues unchanged. When will this political seesaw end? As odd as it may seem, the Republic of Lebanon is being used as a scapegoat for the election of its president. Meanwhile, the head of the Lebanese parliament, Nabih Berri, proposed a political solution. Berri proposed an end to parliamentary sit-ins in central Beirut, provided the government shows serious intention to hold elections and launch a Lebanese-based dialogue aimed at saving the Arab initiative before the situation spirals out of control. Will Berri succeed in mixing oil with water?
In principle, we welcome and accept the proposed dialogue. However, we first need to agree on the agenda. And second, the dialogue must lead to the election of the president. We cannot engage in a detailed dialogue at a time the country is witnessing a presidential vacuum.
The Syrian President Bashar al-Assad talked about the positive positions adopted by Egypt and Saudi Arabia. In addition, the Turkish Prime Minister conveyed a message to al-Assad regarding his country's relationship with Israel. Meanwhile, the U.S. is trying to exit from Iraq with minimum losses, and there are indirect talks going on between Hamas and Israel. All these political developments can help resolve the internal situation in Lebanon, which is linked to national, regional, and international issues.
Despite the fact that the majority has agreed to a conditional dialogue with the opposition, and despite the fact that some positive indicators surfaced at the international level, the Lebanese have their doubts about the success of the proposed dialogue, especially knowing that the decision came from outside the country. The Lebanese disagreement over the language of power sharing comes in the context of a rather large Arab, regional, and international competitive influence in Lebanon. However, the Lebanese have no choice but to keep a window of opportunity open, hoping that their political leadership doesn't waste any more of their time, especially considering that the head of the Lebanese army, General Michel Suleiman, has repeatedly announced that he will step down as the Lebanese top military commander by August 21, 2008. This gives a four-month grace period for all Lebanese politicians to decide on many issues, including the fate of the Arab initiative and the fate of the Lebanese military institution. The slogan of the opposition opposition, political power sharing in exchange for elections, is by and large similar to that slogan, Land for Peace, which to this day has not materialized. This suggests that the future of Lebanon will be dark and the road to recovery will be lengthy, thorny, and costly.
Cattle ranchers in the Bekaa region are confronting a tough battle to continue their work amidst complete absence of official support.
Cattle ranchers in the Bekaa region are engaged in a damaging war, whose weapons are neglect and lack of concern from the government on one side and cheese and milk factory owners on the other. They know that climate change and the effects of various wars are also playing a part. The losses have touched all farms, large and small. The smaller farms, however, are even more negatively affected. The absence of preventative measures to confront the rise in seed prices and the lack of necessary support to farmers have led to the selling off of more than 75% of agricultural lands at cheap prices. In addition, 200 out of 400 farms have closed down to stop losses and pay back loans.
We have three factories in the Bekaa that are monopolizing the prices. We are selling the cattle in order to pay for the feed. Most farmers are selling in order to get out of debt. We appeal to the government to help us a little with the tough situation in the Bekaa.
The price of a ton of cattle feed today is 700,000 liras, and the price of a ton of milk is 850,000 liras. The situation is not good and uncomfortable for the farmers. Anyone who has a farm is selling. In our village of Merj, we had up to 2,000 heads of cattle. Now we have 1,000 to 1,200 heads. Half of the cattle in Merj are gone.
The fall in the price of milk was met with the global rise in the price of feed. The price of one ton of feed is 520,000 Lebanese liras. The price last year was 120,000 liras.
The vast majority of cattle ranchers here in Lebanon have small farms. Those who have fewer than 20 heads of cattle are in need of support to raise their cattle. A large number of them are selling their cattle because they do not have the ability to guarantee the necessary cattle feed for their cattle as a result of the increase in prices.
This man called on the Ministry of Agriculture to secure medicines for the cattle, to provide guidance and support for this industry, as well as to prevent the export of certain amounts of feed in order to sustain the farms in the country.
Why is the American embassy in Paris interested in the French suburbs? Many French have raised this question after it was revealed that an American network has been tempting young immigrants in the suburbs, especially from the Arab Maghreb, to travel to the U.S. for 2 weeks to participate in cultural programs.
Ali Zahi was born in Morocco and grew up in France. Now he's the deputy mayor of Bondy, the suburb that has transformed into a battlefield during the suburb's crisis in 2005. Recently, the American embassy paid for his visit to Washington and to Arkansas to participate in a program that trains qualified candidates on taking leading roles in the future. Previously, the French president, Nicolas Sarkozy, and his prime minister, François Fillon, were some of the beneficiaries of similar American programs. Today, the program focuses on immigrants. Ali does not buy into the conspiracy theory. When he was asked about the U.S. motives behind sponsoring projects in immigrants' neighborhoods, he gave a pragmatic answer, saying, "They offer us organized projects and they are willing to pay for them. Why should we reject such projects?"
After the clashes in the suburbs in 2005, I think that the United States wanted to understand what happened and why. They contacted activists who know what is happening on the ground to learn about the difficulties facing people in some areas in France. My invitation by Washington comes in this context.
Some French point out that U.S. interests in the suburbs started after September 11th attacks and were multiplied multiplied after the invasion of Iraq. CIA officials arrived to France to investigate news reports that commando units have been formed in the suburbs to fight in Iraq or carry out armed operations in Europe and the world for al-Qaeda. The U.S. Embassy in Paris did not deny that this might be a factor in the American interests in the suburbs.
Our cultural program contributes to the enhancement of our national security in the long run. Our policy is not to ignore minorities in the world, including minorities in France.
The American Embassy does not view its invitations to immigrants in the suburbs to visit the U.S. as an intervention in the internal French affairs. Rather, it says that it is only interested in an important segment of the French society. The French are wondering about the American interests in its suburbs. Are the American projects innocent cultural projects? Do they stem from legitimate security concerns? Or are they geared towards empowering a minority that was portrayed as an oppressed minority by the American media during the suburbs crisis in 2005? Hussein Fayad Kneder, Al Arabiya, the town of Bondy, France.
يعد شم النسيم واحدا من أقدم الأعياد التي توارثها المصريون عبر العصور.
Shem al-Nasim is one of the oldest holidays which Egyptians have passed on throughout the centuries. All sectors of Egyptian society participate in the celebration of this holiday, the rich and the poor, Muslims and Copts. There are known foods that Egyptians eat during this occasion, mainly salted fish and colored eggs.
On this day every year, Egyptians go out to parks and gardens to celebrate the spring holiday or Shams al-Nasim. This celebration is not new, but it has its roots in ancient history dating back 5,000 years. The pharaohs were the first to celebrate Shams al-Nasim, which represents the creation of life. Shams al-Nasim lands on the 25th of the month of Barmihat, according to the Coptic calendar. It is when the time of day and night become equal at sundown during the month of Aris. The word Shams stems from the hieroglyphic word Shamo. Nasim represents moderate weather.
It is an old Egyptian holiday. This official holiday goes back to the changes in climate at two levels. First, the start of the spring and the start of the new season. Second, this season is linked to the beginning of flooding of the Nile. Thus, this holiday is officially celebrated because it is considered the start of the bounty and growth.
Just as they inherited the Shams al-Nasim holiday, traditional foods and customs associated with it were also passed down until today. Eggs, salted fish, lettuce, and onions continue to be served as meals by millions of Egyptians during this celebration. All these foods have meaning according to the ancient Egyptians. For ancient Egyptians, eggs symbolizes the transformation from solid to life, as was mentioned in the papyrus, which also said that ancient people painted eggs with wishes and prayers. The fasikh, or salted fish, became an edible item during Shams al-Nasim when the fifth royal family was in power. For the ancient Egyptians, the Nile was the symbol of life. They believed that life on earth started with water and that the fish represented this life. Ancient Egyptians innovated many unique techniques to preserve fish. There's a big difference pertaining to fish. In modern times, almost every time the Shams al-Nasim holiday comes around, food alerts about bad fish are made. The parks and hospitals are put on a high state of alert.
We call the Ministry of Health to provide us with one or two ambulances, so if we have an emergency, the visitors or their relatives can be treated or transported to the hospital.
Onions are also a main item of the spring holiday. For ancient Egyptians, onions represented defiance, fighting diseases and death. In Shams al-Nasim, all Egyptians celebrate together, rich or poor, Muslims and Coptic Christians. All celebrate just like ancient Egyptians used to do. They eat the same food that used to be eaten then and perform the same rituals.
Get more news about the Middle East online at linktv.org/mosaic. The Mosaic webpage offers a complete archive of Mosaic programs, program transcripts, the Mosaic Video Podcast, and the Mosaic Intelligence Report, a weekly analysis of the hottest stories from the Middle East. The views expressed on Mosaic are those of the participating broadcasters, not Link TV or its sponsors. The production of Mosaic is made possible with the support of viewers like you. Thank you. This program was brought to you by Link TV for educational and non-commercial use only. Link TV is the only U.S. television network devoted to global and national news with uncompromising documentaries and diverse cultural programs. Programs which connect you to the world.